Mama.
Mama.
We made it.
Bra, bra, bra.
What it do though?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Mama We Made It podcast. What it do though? We got Keith laughing his ass off right now.
That's beautiful.
That's the intro.
That's how you get it started.
Like, you feel me?
I felt a little low energy when I first came. Now I'm over here like,
I like that.
Nice little song for me.
Just start yelling.
I serenade you with that mama juju.
That's all I need. Y'all got more? Come on now. You got more?
I wish y'all could have seen Joe over here with his like technical difficulty troubleshooting.
And I'm still doing it.
If you've ever seen a white man scared, just know how fucking precious it looks.
We heard his heartbeat.
Yo, for real.
Hey, man. Gotta get the sound cracking for my listeners. I love you.
Man, I'm actually extremely excited about tonight's episode. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Keith Leakes Jr. to the podcast.
Yeah. Okay,
Keith,
hold on.
Keith Leakes Jr. in the building. Right. Let's go.
Y'all, I'm just say this real fast. Y'all added an S on my
I
name.
I did. You like how I came back, Keith Leakes Jr. With the slur? With the slur, with the woo woo.
Okay.
Yeah. Keith Leakes Jr. in the mall. But with the lisp tongue, you know what I'm saying? The additional S that wasn't there.
It's all good.
Oh, man.
Plural.
You know what's crazy? Like, I'm actually extremely excited about this episode. You know, you and I met at a random party.
Dude,
and just
I don't
like,
even know whose party it was at.
Yeah, hit it off. Like, I want to say it was like a diamond jump off, like some just house fight,
something.
Shit.
Something, I don't know.
But that's the beauty of it, because like good people propagate. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And like, I knew from that day forward, I was like, yo, this is a real one.
Dude,
it's been
how long ago was that?
But I want to say it was like a year and a half.
It was
2 years.
Almost 2 years ago.
Yeah, for sure.
And I'm just now getting it.
You feel me?
In the flesh.
We are very happy to have you, my brother.
Oh, dude, I'm happy to be here.
Man, I wanna really, like, you have such a bodacious personality.
Bodacious. Hold on, Nelly said that, right?
I don't even know if we're going to get into this Nelly situations right now.
Let me quit.
He's over here bringing them back, throwing them off the bus, getting fucked for it. You know what I'm saying?
Uh-oh. What's happening now? Like, yeah.
For real. Wow. What's happening now?
I don't know. Ain't none of my business. I ain't getting on no buses.
Oh, man. No, but it's incredible because, like, throughout, from the time that we've met, I've been able to see, you know, your creative expression in full fledge. And it's a gorgeous thing to see how your spirit translates not only through your craft, but just like in your everyday world as well. Like, it's a gorgeous thing to see how close your creative side and your human side actually are. I just feel like that's a recipe for success. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because so many people compartmentalize so many things and have to be this person and have to be that person. And
well, I would like to say this. I feel like there are times when I do compartmentalize. You know what I mean? Like, it's all of that. Like, entertainment, I'm not always the happy guy that you see. You
for
know?
Sure.
I'm not always bodacious. You know?
I respect that.
You know, it's definitely like there's ups and downs. You know? One minute I'm high, the next, not high, but like, one minute I'm feeling good, I'm up, and then the next minute I'm down. You
absolutely
know what I mean?
That's life, though.
It is life, and I feel it. And to say I can't, with me, I want to be honest, and
absolutely,
I can't allow you to say that, you know, like it's that and that.
For sure.
Oh, dude, this is black and white sometimes.
Absolutely.
You know, and it's like real. And
I mean, especially on this path.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
For sure. Just because people expect you to be happy all the time.
Absolutely.
And make people laugh. And, you know, like sometimes I want to make people cry. You know what I mean?
You.
I want to make people feel like other than laugh. Everybody's a comedian nowadays.
Absolutely.
You know, I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't say that I'm a comedian. Like, you know, stand up all the time, comedian. I make people laugh. I look funny. You know what I mean? Like, people like it. I look like Chris Rock. I sound like him. You know, like, things work. But, like, it's just one of those things. It's just not
you're
what it is.
You're a human being.
Yeah, I'm a human being. So, like, my castmates sometimes, they'll I go into my little corner, y'all, and I just be like, I want to be alone. And it's just not like, not necessarily like in a negative way. They
it's just
know.
Decompress.
Oh, dude, when I'm in that corner, don't bother me.
Yeah, you know, need your space too.
Yeah, give me my space and like, don't come in my bubble. Like, give me 50 feet. You know?
I respect that.
Yeah.
No smoking. 50 feet.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Fuck 20 feet. No, 50 feet.
Give me 50. I need the whole 50.
Where'd your journey start out? Where'd you come? Where'd you pop out into this
pop
world?
Out? Well, I came out of my mama's vagina. No, I can't say that. So I'm from Middletown, Ohio.
Oh, wow.
So it's a small little town city between Dayton, Ohio and Cincinnati, Ohio. So, Middletown. Regional Hospital. I don't even know if that exists anymore.
I feel you.
Like, that's where I'm from. Like, it's a complete 180 from this LA.
Did you grow up there?
Oh, I grew up there. Yes. I lived there. I moved to high school. When I went to high school, I started going to high school in Cincinnati, and that was a big culture shock.
Okay.
So I'm like, little.
Because where are you from? Is it very like suburban?
It's not city. It's not like.
Right.
Yeah. So like, it's. It is suburban, and you know, like there's the hood and like whatever. It was a big culture shock when I moved to Cincinnati because it's like Middletown, Cincinnati town, city. Like it was hard.
What was young Keith like?
Young Keith was very artsy. My dad is a musician. My mom is a nail tech, and she doesn't airbrush. She paints, hand paints, stripes and all that.
Awesome.
So I remember my mom always tells this story. When I was, before I was born, she prayed and she held her stomach and she was just like, my baby is blessed. My baby will change things. My baby is this. My baby is that.
Yeah.
My baby is all that in a bag of chips. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
incredible.
And from there, I remember like in school, like, well, let's start at Head Start. My mom said she used to just guide my hand and I used to draw. And she guided it all the time. And
oh, wow.
Before I knew it, I was like drawing on my own.
Oh,
before
wow.
she knew it, I was drawing on my own.
Oh, wow.
And it started from an early, probably one or two.
She oh, was
like,
man. You know, I was early. Just,
like really early. Like that's what I love to do. So instead of like going out and playing, I still played, don't get me wrong, but I was always like drawing and painting and like art, visual arts was my first love.
It's interesting how so many people like that are creative actually you could go off into being an actor or in fashion, but it always starts with drawing, it seems.
For
like,
sure.
That's like the first step. It's just like that entering the creative world.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting that we keep seeing that pattern.
Yeah, for sure.
Dude, I used to like win like art contests. Like my teachers used to put me in them.
Really?
Like, I mean, the whole thing, like I did not see myself doing anything else other than art, like visual arts.
Oh. Oh, wow.
Like, dude, that was my bread and butter. Like, I was able to like get $250 beating people in high school. I'm in elementary school, like in the art contest. Like,
I
it was
love
my
it.
Thing.
What
like,
kind of stuff did you draw?
Portraits. So like the way you are, the way you guys are there right now, like I would be able to draw you just like that.
And did you ever take like a class, or was it just like learning on the go, or
just like doing it, just doing it constantly, like repetition builds, you know? Like,
yeah.
It just keeps going.
That's wild.
And if you do something a lot of time, like if you do something a lot, you become that. And that
for
I became
sure.
a cool ass artist. And I like say, I say that unhumbly, like I don't do it anymore, but like it's something I can just go back to.
It's just ingrained.
It's dude so ingrained to the point where like it, sometimes I don't do it. I know I need to do it more. I know I need to do it now because that's like, that's where I started. Like, I need to move my hands. I need to, like...
Why portrait draw? What got you attracted to that?
I like people. I like seeing people. Mm. I like getting a little twinkle in their eyes. I like detail. I like hair. I don't know. It's really funny. I'm a big Michael Jackson fan.
Yeah.
And I used to draw Michael Jackson all the time.
Oh, wow.
Like, but
awesome.
Not like the black Michael Jackson, like the Michael Jackson that everybody like knows now. The mature Michael Jackson. Yeah. So like permed hair, you know what I mean? Smaller nose, which I love. Like I'm no playing. Like I love Michael Jackson the best thing. Like it's weird. Like he's incredible. So I used to just draw Michael Jackson all the time or whatever, what else?
That's awesome. So, and that's where it started, because portrait drawing is such a I feel like it's such a hard thing. Mm-hmm. It's not like, you know, when people start drawing cartoons.
Yeah, I never liked drawing like cartoons. I did not like cartoons. I never.
Or comic book characters.
Yeah, I never got into it. Like, so, like, I would watch cartoons.
Because for a kid, those things are inspiring. That's what's around you. That's what you want.
But like, I wanted to draw, like, you as you. Not like you as a character, a caricature, or any of that. Like, drawing you, like, right there. Mm. Like, with the, like, I can, like, with having, like, the blue light from the laptop, like, go into your eyes, like, that's what,
I got the blue light. Like, I got the blue light.
That's what I, like, used to, like, that was my thing. Like, I don't, the way I feel I can talk about art, like, visual arts is not the same way I could talk about, like, acting and stuff. Mm. And I think that's part of the reason that
What do you mean by that exactly?
The way I said unhumbly earlier, I wouldn't say that. When it comes to like the performance side, you know what I mean? And I usually don't even like to talk like that, but to stress how like different and how I feel, like I feel great about the performance side. I just don't know enough.
Gotcha. You're still learning.
I'm still learning it. And that's why I stopped doing visual arts. I went to performing arts high school and I had to choose between visual arts and drama. And I didn't even want to do drama at first. But I started getting to like all the shows, like people have been at the school since they were kids. And I come in from Middletown, Ohio with my black ass and I'm doing the big shows. They're like, this kid is good. And the teacher was like, told my mom, like, yo, we got something for him. Da, 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 da.
Wow.
And by the time I was in the 10th grade, I had to choose which one I was going to do. And I remember going to like my mom, my dad. I went to my pastor at the time. Like, wow. It was one of those, like, it was like
a true life decision.
Yeah. Almost. Like, oh my God, I'm getting chills right now just thinking about it. Because at that point in my life, you know, I'm like 26 now. At that point in my life, that was the biggest thing in my life.
Absolutely.
It was the biggest thing. And I just did not understand. I was like, yo, like, I got to make sure I'm making the right decision. And I remember I asked my mom and they were like, yo, whatever you want to do, like, whatever. My dad was like, yo, son, like, whatever you want to do, you do it. Like, do that. I always had the support. But then I was like, I just need somebody else. I just need one more. So I went to my pastor. Whatever you want to do, do it. And, I mean, I ended up making that decision. And, I mean, I think it's a good one.
I feel that.
I think it's a good one. Like, it's so weird. I was so unsure. Like, I didn't want to move away from something that I've done, like, my whole, like, whatever.
What do you think it was in that deciding moment that made you kind of choose something that you were so new to, if you will?
Because I didn't know it. I felt like when I was going to school, like when I was in visual arts class, I felt like they couldn't teach me anything. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, they could, and I learned different techniques, but like the way I got to the same thing that they had was like, it was different, but like I got there without like doing the whole like measurements and doing all the like the technical side was not me, but I was able to pick that up easily.
Gotcha.
So when it came to like acting, I didn't know the technical anything. I didn't know anything. It was just something I had a little bit of a knack for. And I was like, yo, like, if I'm doing this good, I'm coming to this like prestigious school and like people are looking at me and doing that. And I didn't even want to do it at first. My mom told me, she was like, yo, she said, stick it out. I was like, I don't want to do drama. Like, no, like, no. Yeah, like, I don't want to do that. She said, just, you know what I mean? So she's like, just stick it out. Before I knew it, I was doing shows. They like this, that, and other. And it's like, okay, like I didn't know how to do it. And I remember telling my mom, I was like, I'm going to do this because I don't know how.
Wow.
Like, I feel like I was wasting my time in visual arts class too because they weren't as like fun. You know what I mean? They didn't know how to like whatever. I would be making jokes and
for sure
whatever, what else. And I was still like doing what I was supposed to do. And I feel like I did really well there, but it was only so much they could teach me. I think they could teach, what they would teach me is how to be more tamed and quiet. And I didn't want
to
be
that. When you just wanted to break free.
Yeah, you know, I didn't want to be that. So.
It's crazy how in academia, especially like during the beginning of, I guess, any medium's journey, it's so technically driven. And it's, I feel like everybody wants to put people in a box. As opposed to letting their inclinations and their curiosity kind of guide them the process. It's
for
like,
sure.
Oh, you didn't do this technically right? Okay, this isn't how we're doing it here.
Exactly.
It's wild that like in the world of academia, it's so rigid. Especially in this day and age now where it's like there's so much access. It's like I feel like things have to shift.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I think it's even beyond school. And I think that attitude starts at home. Like, the how you grow up is what is, like, that's what they expect you to be. You know what I mean? Like, we're all, like, culturally, we all have our own things. You know what I mean? Like, there are certain things that, like, just growing, like, in a big Christian, like, household, and, like, my dad being, like, a minister and, like, a musician. Wow. And, like, all of that. It's just, like, then, like, me coming out here living my own life and just, like, really just seeing, just, like, yo, like, I take all the good that that has with me, and I do, like, you know what I mean? But you have to figure things out for yourself as well.
Sure. Absolutely.
And, like, you know what I mean? Like, course, you know, sometimes religion gets in the way of, like, real, just, like, you know, just... Like, it's all about spirituality.
For
more
sure.
So, like, religion is the devil. Religion is the devil.
I feel
spirituality
you.
Is where you, how you are connected to God.
Absolutely. So,
like, were you raised pretty religious?
Yeah, but they still allowed me to do whatever I wanted to. Mm. Like, the same thing, it goes back to the, like, yo, if you want to do it, go for it. They never was like, nope, you can't, no.
Yeah.
Like, awesome. I was a good kid, too. So, like, I was a good kid then. But, like, I was a good kid and just... They allowed me to experience. They did.
That's incredible.
And,
that's
and at good. The same time, and at the same time, I didn't experience as much because I was like cool with being at home. I didn't start like hanging out for real, like in high school until like my 11th grade year. And then I started like experimenting and experiencing different things. Just like, yo, like, okay, like, but my parents were like, yo, like, you're a kid, go have fun. Like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? So they were good to me.
With visual arts, you know, as a kid, you tend to do things just because you love it.
Uh-huh.
You're not thinking about like, can I make $1 million out of this? Can I be this for a career? It's all about having fun and just passionate. Was there a time as a kid where you were like, I'm going to be an artist one day? Or was this simply something you just did because you were just passionate about it?
I thought that's all that I would be.
That was, you know, so you were all in on that.
But at the same time, I still like I was dancing around, singing, like all of that was still there. It was just like, this is the number one thing. Like myself, I felt like my sister was the singer. I could sing too. I sing now. It's so weird. And just like, I like to dance and everything. I'm like, just like big, you know what I mean? But
yeah.
Like back then, like I just thought that it was just art, like, you know,
because it could be so much of your identity. You know, we've had guests on here that, you know, they dedicate their whole childhood life and adolescent life to one thing that they're going for. Mm-hmm. But it's such a transformative stage.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going through all these like evolutions of yourself, but you're directed to and focused on this one thing.
Yeah.
And then it kind of takes your identity.
Yeah.
Is that what you felt like happened to you too?
Not with visual arts.
The
thing was, like, it didn't take my identity. It's just like what I really like to do. But like, I felt like if it took my identity, I wouldn't have chose like drama or acting, you know what I mean, at that early age.
Interesting.
I was still always doing stuff. I had done plays and different things. I just didn't see it. I didn't see how close it was, and I didn't start to see it until like my 10th grade year after my 9th grade, when they was like, yo, come do this, come on, like, you got it. Like, I was like, oh, but I've been doing this, but not really realizing that, you know, it was just like, damn, like, I can just jump here.
Got
I'm
it.
Just gonna jump over. I'm just gonna jump. I jumped.
You jumped.
I jumped.
It felt like a jump.
It was a big jump. It was a big jump, and I didn't look back.
What was that transition like for you from, you know, junior high to going to the performing arts school?
So I went to, I wanted to say, what's the name of the school? Dang. Don't ask questions like this. Like, what? I went to a school named Vail Middle School, and it was cool. It was like whatever. I was like, while everybody else was thinning out and getting taller and leaner, I didn't. I was like always really skinny, but my middle school years, I got chubby.
Really?
I was just like, yeah. But I was still hot stuff. Come on now, somebody. I was still hot. I had waves. I think I even got an S curl one time. So my
I
waves
love
was like, this. Like, I'm pretty sure I got like one of those. They was like, Keith, are you mixed? Yes, I'm mixed, girl. So mixed. Like, I don't know with what, definitely not white, but I'm mixed with something. I'm mixed with curl activator.
I love it.
I was mixed with Krill Activator. You have no idea.
And but, you had the ultimate drip.
Oh, yeah. You know, my mom was like always in the salon, so she know how to do it right. I mean, it burned a little bit.
I love it.
Couldn't scratch it. Yeah, looking like a 5-heart beat. Looking like a temptation. You feel me?
Oh, wait.
Yeah.
Just my imagination.
Were you supposed to go to another high school?
Oh, yeah. I was supposed to go to Middletown High School. So from there, went to Bell Middle School. My mom, we were going to church in Cincinnati. And, like, we had gone there for some time now, a few years at this point. And she always said, like, people would see my drawings at church, my paintings. They're like, you need to get him in performing arts. Mm. So that put the bug in my mom's ear. And I didn't understand. I didn't think it would actually happen. Mm-hmm. So when like eighth grade like was over with, my mom was like, we're moving to Cincinnati. This is what it's going to be. We're going to audition. I had to audition for every major there.
Wow. Yeah. So your mom was really pushing it too.
Yeah, she pushes it. Wow. Like she, this is how we grew up. Like, that's amazing. You know, like she was always supportive. Like,
that's awesome.
So we auditioned, and myself, my older sister, and my little sister, we all got into the school.
Oh, wow.
And that's the thing. My little sister is like 5 years younger than me. So the school was 4th grade to 12th grade. So that's already weird. You know, some kids go all the
K through 12 or middle school through high school.
Exactly.
Yeah,
but now the school, now I don't go there anymore, obviously. But now it's like kindergarten through 12th grade.
Gotcha.
Now that I left, after the year I left.
They had the fourth graders to. That's a, like where they get that. Where they get that number?
Exactly. It's so random. At least I was thinking third, maybe, like, you know. Yeah. I mean, you start to think like, yo, maybe if they would have did this, it just doesn't make sense. Fourth is random and shit. Like, what is fourth? Yeah. Yeah, I don't know.
Was that move tough for you?
Oh man, it was. I went into it, you know, happy go lucky. Like, it's gonna be good. I remember me and my sister. Oh man, it's kind of dang. I've not really talked about this. My sister and I, like, she was 2 grades ahead of me, so she was in 11th grade. And I remember telling my mom, I was like, I just want to go back. Mm. Oh, man, I just want to go back. And, like, we were just like, we don't like it. Like, we don't. My mom was like, just give it two more weeks, you know. 2 more weeks, like, 2 weeks came. Give it some more time. You'll be fine. And, like, I mean, you start, like, building friends, but I have never been that person to move. I like grew up in Middletown my whole life, so I knew the people. Like, I was never the new person.
Yeah.
So like, you know, like there were people that were trying to get to like know me at performing arts, but like I didn't really know anybody. It was so random. I ended up seeing somebody that I grew up with there, and it was just like, yo, like Keith. And I'm like, yo, like, yep. Like Kiera, like that's my sister's name as well, but her name was Kiera, the girl. It's like, Kiera. She's like, oh, this is crazy. I'm like, yeah, this is. Like, what are you doing here? Yeah, I'm in I think she was in costuming or something like that. Mm. And it was just random. It was so random. Wow. But definitely did not like the move at first. I liked the idea of moving and getting to do something that like I love to do, which was visual arts. And like, I guess I'm going to do drama at this point.
Yeah.
But like, I didn't like it at
first. It's tough. Mm-hmm. It's tough to move and be the new kid. Like, mm-hmm. What was kind of going through your head at that point? Like,
go back. Just go back. Take your black ass back to Middletown, Ohio, and do your stuff there. Oh, people see you do your art there. You don't have to do it here. You're already good enough.
You feel me? Okay. That little voice was strong, too.
It was deep. It was deeper than the voice. Like, my balls hadn't even dropped at that point, but my like that voice was all big and deep.
I feel that. Was the school mix? Was it like?
It was so many different cultures. So like the school was in downtown Cincinnati, which is over the Rhine. We call it over the Rhine dangerous. So you have like, I mean, just dangerous. Like kids used to come to our school from other schools and jump us. I mean, like it's
really?
A performing
it's like
school.
That.
Wow. So
it's like unicorns and rainbows. They're like fame. Like you got everybody cool. Like,
yeah.
I mean, like it was all of that. So like I had to ride school. City buses. There were no school buses for the high schoolers, so I had to ride like freaking height. Just city buses. I thought it was gross. I'm like, yo, just take me back to Middletown so I can get on this cheese, so I can get on the yellow bus.
You
like,
feel me?
Yeah, like it was definitely a culture shock. It changed everything.
Wow.
And it was a lot of different cultures. You know, whites, blacks. Everybody in between, just like everybody went there, you know.
How'd you adapt to that?
They were just like me. It was easy adapting to that energy.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, it was not easy going into something that I didn't. Like, it's hard to explain. So, it was easy. I felt comfortable around everybody. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because they were, you know, like, they were their own selves. So, I thought, you know, at that time.
Yeah.
Sure.
But it was difficult at the same time in the other sense.
Yeah, I always wonder about that. I never moved away. I know you moved a bunch, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I live here. I live right here, down the street from here.
Oh, shit. Yeah.
I'm still here,
for real.
I live two blocks away from my mom. God. Seriously, it's crazy.
I mean, I've moved around, like, probably seven different grades.
I mean, look.
Like,
really?
Yeah.
In, like, college and stuff, I moved around and lived in New York and did things like that. But as a kid, though, it's just different.
Mm-hmm.
So I always wonder, like, and when you go into a place that's from Middletown to, like, Cincinnati, mm-hmm. big city, there isn't a – you have to – I want to say you have to adapt in what that process is like just with yourself. I'm sure it's like probably lonely at first. You don't really know anyone.
Yeah, I did have my sister, so that helped a lot. And she was, we ate lunch here. We had the same bill, the lunch bill. So we were able to be like, yo, I just want to go. I want to go. Yeah, you want to go too. Let's figure out how we can get mom to go back to the, like all of that. It was all of that.
Were you
like,
pretty close with your sister growing up?
Oh, yeah. Like we used to fight like cats and dogs. Like I used to do everything my sister did. Just like, you know what I mean? She was like an example for me. She's 2 years older. You know, I mean, I have my own friends or whatever, but definitely just like watched a lot of things that she did.
Mm.
Yeah.
Like, that's incredible.
Yeah. That's my girl.
What was the curriculum like in the performing arts
school? Shit. You had real smart people, of course. You know what I mean? You had the people that be in the AV classes, but like we still had to learn and do all of that, but it was not. Yeah. It was the arts was the focus. Wow. The arts was the focus at the end of the day. Like, even though we had all of our classes, we only had a few arts classes, but the arts was definitely like, nobody really cared. It's just like, I'm not here to do this. I ain't here. Don't talk to me about Abraham Lincoln. When he freed the slaves. I heard this story before. I'm in high school. I learned it a couple years ago. For real, for real. Then just like, hold on. I'm just now learning that. Like, it's not even what it was. Dude,
for real.
Like, everything is a lie.
It's wild.
Everything's a lie. I'm over here growing up. I'm like, hold on. So, oh my God, no! How do I tell everybody that it's a lie without seeming crazy? Like,
for real.
Dude, you move out here, you like, that's a lie. That's a lie. That's a lie. Oh my God. You know,
it was all a lie.
It was all a lie. I used to read like it was all a lie. Like, man, I used to make fun of people that used to like say like, This is that. Like, it was like, shut up. Like, shut up. I'm about to slap you. You know, like, that was my energy with that. It got to a point where you start living a little bit. You like, oh my God, no, that's not okay. Like, that's not okay. You don't, no. You know what I mean? From like another perspective.
For sure.
You just start to see people and you have certain friends. You're just like, oh my God, like, are you okay? Like, yo. Like, yeah. It's a lie, y'all. It's a lie. I'm not going to say what, because I'm just saying, but most of it is a lie.
For real.
It's a lie.
For real.
This tea is the truth, though.
It really is, right? The melange.
With that tea.
The mint melange with a little bit of honey. Mm-hmm. So take us through that transition to drama.
Okay. So I was in I had like three bells. Or two bells. I can't remember exactly, but I had two bells of arts. Let's say two. Two bells of art, and I had one bell of drama. But I'm in the ninth grade, and they had me with the seventh graders.
Mm. And that's a big difference, by the way.
It's the biggest difference.
It's 2 years.
They had you fucked up.
Yeah, but
that's
wanted,
a big difference.
They had me with the seventh graders.
Let me explain.
I know what it sounds like. So I was just like, I'm like, okay, like, I'm just, my mom said, stick it out. I'm going to stick it out. You know what I mean? Like, I remember, like, going there.
Shit, I would have walked out.
You see what I'm saying? I kind of listened. I'm a little hard-headed, but I kind of listen.
I feel you. I would have shimmied right the fuck out of
there. Yeah, you see what I'm saying? Like, they didn't put me where I belonged.
Yeah.
But hold on. I mean, there's more.
That's a slap in the face.
Oh, but it wasn't. It was that was humbling. because I didn't understand. It's like, okay, yeah, okay, seventh graders, all right. I'm just sticking it out. They younger than me. What they going to say? You know what I mean? There was a couple other people that was in my grade. I'm like, why are you here? You've been here a couple years. Like, what you been doing? Now you're there. Like, what's going on with you? Like, come on now, baby girl. You should not be here. This is my first year. You've been here since the fourth. I don't understand why you all the way in seventh grade drama. Like, I don't know why. No, come on. But what was the question? Like, I started going on.
No, just that transition into drama. So they had you at a level below.
Yeah, they had me a couple levels. I was in the ninth grade. I was in the seventh grade class.
Wow.
And there was like some sixth graders in there. So there were some people that would move like that were above.
Oh,
like,
shit.
You see what I'm saying? So yeah. I was held back twice in a sense, you know?
Yeah.
But I mean, they just need to see where I was. And before I knew the transition into it, it was like I did that and I did this. And then before I knew it, like I started to like it. After those couple weeks or whatever,
yeah.
I was like, I can do this. I'm watching all the seventh graders. I'm like, I got this.
You yeah. know,
you get a little cocky, get a little arrogant. You're like, okay, let me go for it. And I want to say after they started auditioning for the show the beginning of second semester. And we had like a showcase and my mom came and my drama teacher, Mr. Roth. Oh, Mr. Roth, I love you so much, man.
Shout out to Mr. Roth.
Yeah, shout out to Mr. Roth. He believed. He really believed. I could cry right now. But he told my mom, he was like, I really want to use Keith for this main stage show. Da, 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 da. And our main stage show, we went to like the big theater and like not at our school because people used to come and watch our shows. And,
it was a big thing.
We had like tech kids and everything. They used to build our sets. Kids used to build our sets. Oh, it was like artsy. Like it was the dream. Like it was the dream. It was a dream. Like I don't know what it is now, but I know what it was when I went there. And he told my mom that, and she's like, okay, good. She's like, Keith, you know that? I said, well, yeah, he told me a couple of days ago. I auditioned for it and I beat everybody.
I love it.
There were two casts just in case. So like there was another cast, but I was like one of the only black people in it. You know what I mean? Which is another thing. Like looking back, the I don't know. It's just a lot of people couldn't go and like, I don't know. Like, I don't even want to say the wrong thing. It's just like people are taught a way of life and it's so much more to just what we're taught. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
Like, I mean, the roles that they had, like a lot of black kids honestly couldn't do. But I guess I spoke a little differently, you know, just coming from Middletown, it was a little easier for me to like roll over into that.
Mm.
And that's something I'm dealing with now. It's just that shit is not okay. You know what I mean? Like, I should be able to speak the way I want to, and you should love me.
Absolutely.
If I want to speak, in Ebonics, bitch, like, love me for that. And at one point, I was like, man, like, I didn't understand it. I just understood, like, people ask me why I talked the way I talked. But I was like, oh, but this is what they kind of like, and I don't get it. This is just what it is. Mm-hmm. I didn't know.
What was that like growing through the drama steps for you? Like how was that high school experience?
The high school experience was really good to me. Like it got to a point by so was in that show. Of course, next year they were expecting me to do it again. Like people started noticing who I was and like talking to me. It's like, Keith, you were really good. Like the school was able to come to the theater that we performed at the Aronoff Theater. Oh yeah.
What it do,
Aronoff? Like the kids would come, the high schools would come, different high schools would come, and then we would have our night shows. Like we wouldn't be at school for like the whole week. Mm. Like they treated us like we were on like Broadway or something. Like that's what I thought. Or like we were just like professional actors.
Mm-hmm.
So like the next year I was able to do the next show. So the first year I did it, it was a comedy. Then the next year we did like some Shakespeare. We did like Medea, a Greek play, a Greek tragedy. So it's like I had to go from that to that. And then the next one, the 11th grade year, was another comedy. And that's where I'm really like, yo, like,
yeah,
have fun. And then the last one, my senior year, I didn't even audition for the play. I didn't audition. I was sick. I got into a fight with my ex-girlfriend's boyfriend or whatever.
Oh.
And I tried to kiss her at a party, you know, like being kids, doing things that we shouldn't have done.
Yeah.
And like he was there and I don't know what I was thinking, but I tried to kiss her and she wasn't okay with it. And I guess he came around and was like, what's wrong? She told him. And when I knew it, he was like, let's go outside. I said, okay. Who's going to do something to me? Like, what? Okay, let's go outside. But my okay was more so like, okay.
Yeah.
Like, whatever. And everybody's walking downstairs. And I could, the energy, I'm like right behind him. He's first. We're going down the stairs. And like, this group of people are walking behind us. As soon as he opens the door, gets out, he says, dude.
Oh.
And I said, clink. He said, clink, clink.
Oh, he just turned around right
yeah,
away.
Yeah, but I mean, all my dumb ass should have known. He said, let's go outside. Like, yeah. If I watch anything, I watch Jerry Springer more. They said, let's go outside. I'm going to beat your ass outside. I know what that means. I don't know why I was so, like, naive to the fact that he was about to whoop my ass. I got a few hits in. I did get a few hits in. Uh-huh. Yeah, I had that in there. Uh-huh. Get a couple
You're
hits
damn
in.
Damn right.
But, I mean, at that point, my eye was already black. Yeah. It was blacker than black. I was bloodshot red. Oh, went upstairs. Man. He couldn't come back up. Like, people felt bad for me because I am, like, a fun guy. Yeah. So people did feel bad for me. Yeah. But it got
the
to the point.
Turned.
Yeah, it turned. And I laid down, woke up, my face was swollen, home, told my mom that I wasn't at a party, that I was staying at my homeboy Eris's house. And Eris is probably one of the reasons that I'm out here right now.
Wow.
I'll tell you more about him in a bit. Mm. I remember telling her, I was like, yo, we were at some party. Eris was like throwing some party, always throws parties. And like, I was dancing real hard. Mama, you know, I'd be dancing. And then like, I don't know. I'd like, me and somebody bumped heads.
Oh.
I just told her this year that it was because of a fight. I just told her this
Mom,
year.
Do you have a minute?
Yeah, it was just random. She was like, she asked me, you know, it's funny. She actually asked me. She was like, she said, did somebody punch you? I said, no, I was dancing hard.
Okay.
So like, I was like that. That was like that was a Friday night. Saturday, like my eye was, I was just laying down and I got really sick. I got really sick. And I will say, right before that, I had auditioned for my first musical. I never thought that I would do a musical in my life. Mm. So, like, a couple weeks before that audition, got in there. Cool, whatever. I'm like, yo, I'm starting to sing now. I'm about to start dancing. Like, ooh, let me do my thing.
Yeah.
But then there was also the audition for the main stage show, and that's what I do every year. And, like, I got sick. Thank God I got sick because my eye was red. I had strep throat, like,
wow,
all white, oof, like, all of that. But it was the best time for me, y'all. Y'all understand, I had to, like, everybody knew I just got beat up. So I, like, I didn't have to deal with the bullshit of going into, like, school and everybody seeing my eye bloody. Like, you know what I mean? So yeah. I got sick, and I decided to stay sick for a couple weeks, which means I was sick for a good 3-4 days, and then I went and got checked out. Oh, you got tonsillitis. Like, you got strep throat. Okay, well, take this. I'm going to need a couple more days for this eye to go down. Yeah. I'm still sick. Like, you see that on my throat? And, like, it got to a point where the auditions came up, and I was too embarrassed. I'm like, I was way too embarrassed to go in for the audition. Oh. And my drama teacher, this is why, I wish I would take this advice for myself now. This is why you do good by people and you, like, show your ass off. Because I missed audition, and he said, Keith, he said, are you, like, what's going on? I said, I'm just still really sick, lying ass.
Yeah.
I'm still really sick, this, that, and the other, like, blah, blah, blah. He said, okay, well, I have a part. Actually, I have 3 parts for you. So, I mean, I didn't get the main, but, like, I was able to, like, with it being such a big situation, I was able to, like, get 3 different parts, 3 totally different characters, which he knew I was capable of doing.
Mm.
So, like, I didn't audition. People were pissed. Like, even people, like, I mean, at the end of the day, people supported me. People loved me. But, like, why should I?
Right.
When I'm taking 3 roles. You know what I mean? And I was okay with that. He was like, I'm going to give them to you. He said, like, this, that, and the other. I was just like, oh my God. I told my mom, I was like, Mom, this is what happened. She was like, well, I mean, that's what happens. You're blessed. Remember? I was, you know what I mean?
I love
that. It's one of those. It's just like, that's what you get. You get that. Mm. That's what you get. Mm. Like, everybody don't get that. You get that. Like, you are blessed. Like, you're going to be okay. Even when it's like, that's what you get. That's your life. You will always get that.
Like, I love that.
So it doesn't make sense. I mean, didn't get the biggest role. Didn't need the biggest role because I had 3. You know what I mean?
I love it.
I had 3. Oh, man. Dude, I've not talked about that in so long.
That's incredible.
I'm getting hot. I'm getting sweaty. And then I'm getting chills. I don't know how I feel. Am I getting a fever right now?
What drew you to acting and performance? Where you just, you know, more than just an interest, like where'd the love develop for it?
Just being on the stage and being able to be someone different, you know, and probably like play, just like to just go somewhere else, you know, and like to be able to cuss on stage a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, honestly, like, I mean, like, I didn't cuss a lot growing up. And I mean, I had my moments where I would be like cussing a little bit, like, oh, bitch. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But just like being able to do that and just like go outside of what I was like taught, you know, mm-hmm. like just like as a Christian and all of that. But like my parents still supported me. Like I still had their support. They were like, yo, go ahead.
I love it.
Go ahead.
That's really pivotal though. Mm-hmm. 'Cause a lot of times like the home, it really sets the tone for, you know, who we become yeah. or who we rebel into.
Right? Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
Especially coming up in a home that has strong ties and beliefs to the church.
Uh-huh.
But it's a beautiful thing that you had parents that had that tie, but also was like, look, you still have to learn yeah. and grow on your own.
Yeah.
These are the foundational elements, mm-hmm. but you're going to have to play within these. It's not like the word of God is yeah. is yeah. all saying.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. There was still a little bit of rebellion too, though. Don't get yeah. twisted. There was that as well, you know, and I feel like I think that was the older I got.
Really?
So yeah, that was a lot of
rebellion. What do you think that was?
Just experience, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Because I was a good kid, so it's just getting the experience and just like being like, oh, like I was saying earlier, that's not right. That's not like, you know what I mean? Like now I look at all my friends and I'm just like, yo, like we all know, like my castmates, it's just like, yo, like the stuff that people are being fed is not real. Mm-hmm. It's so not real. It doesn't really exist. It's like man-made. And like we're over here, like we can see outside of it. Like, yeah. Part of it is because we do entertainment and we know, like, it's just like, yo, like how much of it is really real? Like I get enjoyment out of people performing and stuff, but like watching TV now is so like, oh my God, it like hurts. Or like watching like people just like sketches and everything, even watching myself, it's just like, well, I know what I have to do to get there. You know what I mean? Or I know like how many times we had to do this for this to turn out this way, or like the magic of it is gone. The magic is just making people believe now, you know?
Look, it's wild. Like you have to play within those boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the compartmentalization comes exactly. in. You have to be able to be like.
Exactly. Yep. Yeah. Dude, all of it. Some stuff's up here, some stuff's down here. So I'm trying to like bring this stuff down.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'm trying to bring it all the way up here. Okay, we got all these boxes down here. Let's just move these. Keep them there for a little bit.
For sure.
You know what I mean?
For like, sure.
Not ready to pick those boxes up yet.
Did you kind of begin to find yourself more through being able to express yourself in so many different ways? Like what?
Yeah, for
sure.
Does
that just allow you to blossom into,
mm-hmm.
I guess it allowed you to explore kind of like areas within oneself, mm-hmm. and especially like in terms of expression, mm-hmm. like what was that like for you? Especially like at, 'cause I feel like high school is such a formative
yeah.
period
yeah.
for all of us in that, you know, we either get really comfortable or we start to kind of like, you know, bring it in and
or there's both. And I yeah. always like, I'm a Libra, and I don't know if y'all in the signs, I'm not, but somebody told me I was a Libra because my birthday's on this date.
Yeah.
And with that being said, like I'm all about balance, and I find myself saying like, yo, it is this, but then it's also this. Mm-hmm. Like it's just that balance going yeah. back, that scale, just like, where am I? Who am I today? How do
for
I
sure.
feel? Okay, well, you know what I mean? Well, this goes up, this goes down, round and round, up and down.
Left and right.
Left and down.
We here tonight.
Dude, it is like everything. It's everything.
When you started to get towards graduation time, what was in your mind? Like, what'd you have?
Coming out here. Coming out here and like leaving as soon as like I'll start going to school out here. Everything was on my mind. It was to be like to be just a multifaceted, like just doing everything. Like I can still do art. Like that was still in my head, you know what I mean, at that point.
Yeah.
It's still there. I think about it all the time.
Yeah.
But like acting, singing now. Like my parents support me singing. Like that's not even what I'm like. That's my sister thing. That's my dad's thing. Like now I'm singing too. I might not be the best, but I can act like it. You know what I mean? Like just play with it. It's just like really finding characters within that and just really like going somewhere. And like even dancing. I always loved to dance. I was dancing my senior year is when everybody was like, oh, Keith is like not even a triple threat. He's just like somewhere else. Like, I don't even know how many, what the fuck else can he do? Like, and that's, it was cool because like the whole time I was there, I knew what I could and I would see people perform and I was just like, support. But I'm like, I can do that too.
Yeah.
Like when you finally do it, they're like, yo, like people really didn't know. People had no idea. And I knew, but I never done it in front of people. Mm-hmm. So it's just like, once you go for it.
Yeah. There's also that belief factor. Yeah. Like once you get it done, you start to be able to believe it too.
Yep. And then when you have parents that support, like that really goes hand in hand. Like there are things that, you know, we all wish our parents could have done better.
Absolutely.
But like they did a pretty good damn job. Even with the things that I don't like. You know what I mean? They did. They were kids too. That's what I keep trying to tell myself. It's like they were, when they had me, they were a couple years younger than I am now.
Wow.
Like I could not see myself having a kid or raising a kid right now.
For sure.
I am like, I'm 26 going on 15. Like, you feel me? Like, I'm a kid. I'm like, what were y'all doing? Having sex, getting married? And like, no, like, stop that. Like, what are you doing to yourself? Don't hurt my mom. Like, get off of her. Like, y'all should not have been doing that. We should, like, take your time, people. If you listening, take your time having kids. Like, figure it. It is not a joke. It's not a joke. But having their support really, like, that helps. Like, I look at some friends now and they're just trying to get over the aspect of not having their parents' support.
For sure.
And like, it's something that's so common now. Like, if I didn't have their support now, I would be able to get past it because I had their support so much in the beginning. I mean, it's never
that's
easy.
Extremely important, especially in the creative realm.
Oh yeah. Huge. Yeah. Cause that's
almost impossible to sell to a parent.
When you don't have that, that's something else on your back that you're taking that weighs very heavily. Oh, it weighs you all the way down. You know, like in Mario when like he gets smashed or whatever, it makes you that little.
Yeah,
it will.
Sure.
I mean, granted, I didn't have to go through that, but like I see people that do, and it's just like, yo, keep pushing, keep going. You gotta do it. Like if your parents weren't there, like as a friend, I'm gonna be like, yo, whatever you want is yours.
For sure.
Whatever you believe is yours. Like it's you got the power to do it. Like they didn't do it. I'm not saying I'm here, your parent or whatever, but I just want you to know. Just keep on pushing because your time's coming, everything that you ever hoped for, everything that you ever saw, everything that you are, like it's coming, it's there.
Yeah,
so there.
Absolutely.
I love that
for sure,
dude. I'm getting chills.
You feel me,
dude?
What was coming to LA like?
It was great. It was great. Because I went to perform in art school. Half of
what school did you go to?
And then I came to school out here.
Okay.
So with going to performing arts, a lot of people come out here. They either go to New York or come out here or wherever else, any like big city, you know, just to like go and make it. And it was easy because like there were people that graduated like 3 or 4 years ahead of me that were out here. So awesome. I was able to transition into that and have people. And like it's so crazy. I ended up dating somebody that was in my sister, like her name. I don't even want to say her name right now because we're not talking and whatever. But we dated in college and she was 2 years ahead of me. So she was in my sister's grade.
What college you go to?
AMDA, American Musical and Dramatic Academy.
And it's here in LA.
Yeah. It's in Hollywood.
Awesome.
And, like I started dating her, but when we were in high school, I looked so much younger than what I was, and she used to like treat me like I was way younger.
Yeah.
And she used to be like, she's like, oh Keith, you want to be my boyfriend? You want to be my boyfriend? It was cool to see that like a couple years later, we're both out here. It was cool.
So you had somewhat of a little community.
I had a community, and it was easier for me. Like it wasn't the same for me moving from Middletown to Cincinnati. It was like me coming into like people I knew. So it's just like, I could call people. As soon as I got here, I was staying with one of my friends that she went to performing arts, but she was living in LA, like in a hood somewhere. Mm. I was able to stay out here for a week before I even started school. So I was just like going out, doing that, like hanging out with my friends. They had apartments in Hollywood.
Was it intimidating at all knowing that every actor in the entire world comes here to LA?
No, because like I'm one of them.
Yeah.
Everybody comes out here. Like, it goes back to that whole belief situation. I mean, I think I find myself being a little bit more insecure and finding, like, I'm starting to get jealous now. I'm trying to remove that. Like,
real.
Oh, yeah, dude. Like, back then, I don't know what it was. I think it was just that purity that I had. Like, I'd never felt that way. Like, you just asked that question. I'm like, it didn't bother me that all the other actors were here because I'm one of them. Like, we rub shoulders.
Sure.
You're one of me. But now it's just like, I find myself like looking at certain things. You just go through certain shit. You like, yo, like, I'm jealous. Where did that jealous spirit come from? Mm. Where did that negative, like, what did I do? Mm. Where did I go wrong? What made this? Oh, like, I know. Oh, okay. Like, I got to stop. I got to get that out of there. We got to move it out. So
for sure.
I'm definitely battling with that now.
Well, because I was thinking more like in Cincinnati, you know, the community is obviously much smaller.
Yeah.
And don't take this the wrong way, but you can kind of be a big fish in a small in a small pond.
Yeah.
You know, but when you come to LA, it's like all the big fishes and all the big ponds are here. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really the ocean.
But at that point, it didn't bother me. It really didn't.
That's really cool to hear.
It didn't. I was just going to school, too. I was going to school, too. So it's just like that was where my focus was. They didn't want us to go out and like audition and any of that. So I'm just getting my education. I've already been to a performing arts school. I get to this school, and it's just like they let anybody in. And I'm like not motivated. I'm looking at you like, how the fuck did you get in here? Like, you shouldn't be here. Okay. Like, you shouldn't. Like, you don't have the same thing. Like, you don't have it. Remember earlier I said the kids at that school had that same thing.
Absolutely.
This didn't.
For sure. Yeah.
They didn't have it. It's all about the money.
What'd that do to your spirit?
My spirit, it drug it down to a point where I ended up, after five semesters, I was like, I ain't doing it no more. I'm not going back. It definitely took it down. It made me not motivated. Like, I'm not saying I procrastinate. I hold out because I know I can get away with things, you know? Yeah, like, I'm definitely guilty of that.
Yeah.
But, like, just there, it was beyond not even that. It was just, like, not even going to class and getting away with it because I could. I figured out loopholes, you know? Like, okay, I guess I got to go to the doctor this way. Like, I got insurance, like, whatever, figure it out. Like, it was one of those. It's just, like, yo, I shouldn't feel like that, you know?
Yeah.
And I just wasn't doing what I should have. And it's just like, yo, I'm wasting all this money. Mm-hmm. And my dad is on this parent plus loan. And like, you know what I mean? And he's like believing in me. And like, I didn't grow up with my dad in the household either. So the fact that he was my main provider at that point, like I was getting $50 a week, y'all.
Oh,
like at college, making it happen. And me living like that now, I could not.
No.
I could not. $50 a week. I was brisks. Freaking noodles, like having people make me food, people that just loved me. Like, I did not. That was rough. That was rough, but I didn't realize how rough it was. It was my life, so I made it work.
Yeah.
Wow.
What's interesting, because also, like, in LA, actually, just forget LA, just being an actor, the motives really span across a huge spectrum.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
And there's a lot of people that love the art of it, love the are inspired by it, are driven by theater, driven by the stories and the development. And there's also the same, you know, a ton of people that come here with the motives to be famous, to win the popularity contest.
Okay, with you saying that, like, this is something I was just talking to my friend about. At, like, performing arts schools and, like, theater-based whatever, they don't want you to focus on, like, wanting, like, that they don't. They don't think you're going to book, so they say, no, you don't. You can't want fame. Like, you can't want that. I don't think that's a bad thing, wanting it. It does give you some type of security in a sense. Like, it depends, like, with what you're working with. Not all the time.
For sure.
You got to build it up or whatever. It's just like, you know, you want people to know your work.
Yes.
You want people, you want to be respected. You know what I mean? Like, they make you feel that you should not want any of that. It's like, yo, me, like, if I was living here as long as I wasn't, I mean, the last few years, people stop me wherever I am sometimes. Like, yo, I'm like, yo, I could be having a bad day. That's what brings me joy. Like,
absolutely.
I can be, like, going through a depression. Like, I go through my depressions. I really do. Like, no lie, y'all, depressed sometimes.
Yeah.
And, like, if somebody stops me and they recognize my work, it makes me feel so much better.
For
I'm not saying that I need that, like, but sometimes I need it. It's just, like, that extra push.
Yeah.
They tell you don't desire it. They tell you not to want that. It's just like, no, if that's what you want, that's what you get.
For sure.
You get what you want. Like,
at the same time, I feel like it's a little, like, there's a duality to that because, you know, those, at the end of the day, let's say somebody gets to that level, right? Fame is something that will break somebody down.
Yeah.
Or you're either going to adjust and adapt to what it brings you.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And I feel like a lot of times, you know, and this isn't everybody, but to want the accolade and to want that feeling without knowing what that is. Like, if you find out, cool. But to want that feeling without having put the arduous work in, I feel like it's setting oneself up for a rude awakening.
Exactly.
Then there are those that grind at their craft. Grind. Yeah. They want that recognition.
Yeah.
They want that.
But they work in too.
And they, yeah, and then they work towards that. Some of them are happy there. Some of them adjust there. And some of them leave there.
Yeah.
But I feel like the fight for what it is you want comes at that price, as opposed to just wanting it and being in it for the allure or the thought of it.
Oh, no, no. That's not where I am. That's not where I am. Like, it just, you know,
it's so funny too in Los Angeles. Like, I hate when people start talking about the whole, like, you know, everybody in LA is so fucking fake. And I'm like, look, bro, like, it's like that in fucking Montana too.
Take your ass to Middletown, Ohio. This shit
is all relative. You know what I'm saying? But then when you speak to people, it's almost just blasé. Like, oh yeah, you know, I'm trying to be an actor.
Yeah, yeah.
There's just a difference in that belief and also just the effort being put in a craft as opposed to just speaking on it so nonchalantly.
Oh yeah.
And I mean, it goes with anything, like finance, being a doctor, like, you know what I'm saying, like sports athletes, all that, like, there's just a different breed.
There is. And that, remember, like, that's the night that I met you. Like, I felt like it was the same type of, like, feeling. You know,
1,000,000,000%.
It was just like the conversation was like, oh, like, okay, yeah, this happened. Okay, yeah, what do you do? But it was just like, it felt good. It was like, it was real. It wasn't that bullshit.
Because it was two human beings talking to each other.
Exactly.
Yep. It wasn't like one actor and then one fucking. Yeah. Right, it was like, right, oh, cool. Right. What do you do, bro? Like, That's the beauty of, like, humanity, bro. Like, especially, you know, in this city, and especially in these realms, it's rarely do you find people that know the human being first as opposed to the shell of who they are. You know what I mean? And I feel like you get to appreciate people so much more when you know them and attach their being to their aspirations, whatever they may be. With that being said, you came out here, you knew this is what you wanted to do. You knew this was your calling, and you knew you were damn good at it, and you were going to be great at it. With leaving the school, what was in your head at that point?
Like, scared.
Really?
I'm scared. Definitely scared. Like, that's when it was like, I got to figure it out. I got to get a job. I got to see, what am I going to do different? Like, I'm not in school. Like, for the first couple, like, I want to say month or two, like, I even went and tried to, my friend who was going to the school still tried to get me representation, like management. And I went, I've never told this story for real. Because, like, got to a point where, like, I went in there, I did my monologues, and I'm an overactor, y'all. I overact my ass off. I will kill you in the overacting contest. I'm so over the top. Like, like, you know what I mean? They say it's all in the eyes. I'm like, it's all in the teeth. Like, like, it's all of that. So, like, he tried to give me, like, management. I went in there, did my two monologues. He said, I think he needs a little bit more work. They were all, like, in there. I did it in their office. He said, he needs a little bit more work. I mean, we'll do a trial period with you, whatever. After that, I was like, they didn't like me right off rip. I ain't doing nothing. No. I said, you know what? I did a YouTube video with somebody. I said, I'm gonna, like, create my own work. I'm gonna create my own work. Like, this is the thing. Like, people are gonna see me how I present myself. You know what I mean? Whether it's, like, actually me, it's gonna be a representation of me because it's my work. And I'm gonna collaborate with my friends, and we're gonna figure it out. So, like, I didn't look back. Like, he would send me, like, emails saying, like, you know, we're having an event, come to this, like, this and that. I would not even respond. It's just, like, I didn't like the way they talked to me. Because if I'm going to work with you, I don't want you to, like, you know what I mean? Like, it's a way to go about it. Like, if you want to work with somebody, you're going to give them a trial period. You make them feel loved. I shouldn't feel scared of you.
You're not just one of the cattle that's just, like, chilling. Like,
no,
one of the
you can't treat me like that. That's not how I was brought up. And that's not how my parents treat me.
It's not
so,
inspiring,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, you got to, like, treat me the way you got to treat me like you want to work with me. I mean, beyond you sending me.
It's also rare to have that type of personal conviction, though, no? Because a lot of people just want to be down.
Oh, for like representation and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, just in general, for you to be able to be like, you know what? Like, I don't like the way y'all went about this, so I'm going to do it on my own.
Well, I think that it goes to because of how I was talked, how I've always been talked to, and how I've always been respected too. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I don't know if it's my parents or what, how I grew up, what it is, but like, there's people do treat me a certain way, and when I don't get treated that way, I throw fits.
I feel you.
I throw fits, or it's just like, okay, well, you did that. Like, some people don't even know who I am sometimes, and that's like, great. I don't want you to. Like, I don't want my friends to ever say like, oh, he does this, who does, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and that's cool, but like, certain people, once they figure out like what is who I am or what they've seen me in,
yeah,
the whole energy changes. I'm like, like that's not like, I just want to have a conversation with you, or you know what, no, I don't even want to be here for real. I'm gonna go I'm gonna just leave, or just like, I'm gonna be over there in that corner, don't bother me.
For sure.
Leave me alone.
For sure. Your 50 feet of space.
Like, yeah, like 50 feet. Give you me 50 feet. Give me 50 feet. Y'all can't see it, but we dancing right now.
50 feet.
Are you crip walking?
Incorporate a little shoulder roll in there.
Yeah. Go ahead. What, your best. Oh.
What kind of parts do you go for as an actor? I'm just curious to like, because there's all different types, right?
Yeah.
People who are like heavily into the drama.
Yeah.
People who are like comedian actors.
Yeah.
What's your forte?
Well, when I was like legitimately always creating my own work after I left school, I was putting out comedy, like music videos.
Awesome.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, so it's easy for me to go that route. But like I said earlier, remember when I started doing the shows, like 1 year it'll be comedy, then the next year it'll be like real dramatic tragedies or some Shakespeare and
exactly.
stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that's still like that's how I started out. So like that's still there. It's like I still have that. Like I want to, but like branding wise and everything else, like right now it's just like
comedy's
I really feel like I'm paying my dues.
Sure.
Like, you know what I mean? I'm definitely paying my dues. I'm trying to figure out, you know, who I am. Like what I am. Like, you know, I'm at that place where things are changing, you know, and it's so cool because like comedy is like at the forefront right now, but it's so much more to me than just comedy.
For
like
sure.
I love the arts. Like,
can you take us through that process of trying to figure out, especially like as you're leaving school, as you left school, figuring out who you are, and when you say you know you develop your own content,
yeah,
it kind of even before that, it's like. You have to develop it within yourself,
yeah,
who you are.
And with other people that are around you. Like, collaboration is key. Like,
Did you have a conversation with yourself? Or, like, what was that
it was
process
prayer,
like?
My parents, you know, trying to figure things out. I knew I needed a job because my dad was just only sending me $50 a week still.
Yeah.
That didn't change. Sometimes I would get $100. And I was like, Dad, you give me $100. Like, I got $100. Like, that's cool. I got $100. What y'all, y'all want some chips? You want some chips? You want some chips? I got an extra dollar to spare. You can get 5 chips this week. That's $5 for you, bro. I know you hungry too, you know? But, it was difficult, but once again, one of my friends was out of school who I was living with, Tessa Von Der Haar. I love you. Thank you so much. My hands are open. Like, my arms are open wide right now.
You got the,
I just want to thank you because Tessa allowed me to live with her a few times out here. Like,
awesome.
A few times. It's one of those. Like, when you move to LA, you will get homeless, but you don't got to sleep on the street. You will go homeless, but you don't got to sleep on the street, y'all.
Yeah. The couches are extremely comfortable.
Oh,
in this vicinity.
Man, I didn't even realize that. Like, I got back problems because I slept on so many couches. I'm a couch hoe. I'm such a couch hoe. I didn't even realize at one point where I was living, when I was living with Tessa, I didn't realize like I was still sleeping on couches because I was like paying rent there and everything. But going back to what we're talking about, I had to get a job. She was working somewhere. She was working at Mendocino Farms. And y'all, Mendocino Farms is the place that I got discovered. So that's another thing.
Wow.
So she was able to get me a job. I came in there. I wowed them. I'm like, yo. She's like, oh, so you know Tessa? Yeah, I know Tessa. She cool, right? Yeah, she cool. Okay, you got the job pretty much. I mean, like,
awesome.
It was, I had to fill out stuff and all that and went through a whole process. But it was one of those from the beginning, felt comfortable.
Yeah.
And I just started creating my own work right after that. I met people that worked there. And somebody that worked there, Jason was like, he used to direct all my stuff and he really believed and he used to like shoot it and just everything. It was so cool because he wanted to do stuff too. So we just got together. Tessa was like, yo, you need to talk to Jason. I was like, okay, blah, blah, blah. So one of my homeboys, he had this song. It's so crazy. He had this song back in high school that he wrote. It was called "That Girl, She Ain't Got No Ass. That Girl, She Ain't Got No Ass, But She Can Shake It Though." And I thought it was, it sounded like some Soulja Boy. It was like, yeah. Like if I played it for you guys, it sounded like some cool, like fun song. And yeah. I always used to laugh at the song, like in a comedic way. I'm like, this shit is lit, but it's really, really funny. Like,
yeah.
So like he had the song. I said, yo, can I take this song from you? Like, can I have this song? Like, I want to do like a music video, like random, like, you know what I mean? Yeah. So it was like, he was like, yeah. I said, but like, I got to figure out like the concept. It has to have like a concept. I can't just be like that girl. She got to have like, I can't just do that. Like, that's not me. Cause I thought the song was funny.
Yeah.
So I used to have all these conversations on the balcony with Afton Garrett. Afton, I love you too. Arms are wide open. We used to talk on the balconies, and the conversations I have on balconies, I always say back then I was living like kind of downtown, I don't know, Lincoln Heights in the hood somewhere, but we had these like nice condominiums. It was like cool, like three stories or whatever. I shouldn't have been there. Like I kept moving and everything. And, we had a conversation about like all we want to be and like what we are and everything. And we would have them all the time. And it, one time we were just in the house at this point, and I said, I want to make this a spray. I want to make this no ass, she can shake it though spray. So it's just like, yo, so it's going to be an infomercial. And she was like, oh my God. So she started coming up with like, so we're like going back and forth. It was like, all right, so she don't got no ass, but when I spray it, she going to be able to shake it though. Yeah. You know what I mean? So it was a whole like spectacle, like music video thing. It was like, I came out with the beginning, like monologue or like scene, and you had girls that's dancing and like just shaking their ass, slapping their ass. On the street, oh my God. And you have this one girl who's just looking at all these asses, and she just sits down at the bus stop, and I came in and said, she said, thought about changing your like something, your pancake into like whatever, like, you know, some crazy whatever.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, I can't really help you with that, but you're gonna be able to shake it though. And I pulled her off, and it just goes into a music video, and I'm rapping. Yo, I don't know how to rap. Like, you know,
I love it.
So then it's just like, you know, like, that girl, she ain't got no ass, she ain't got no ass, but she can shake it though. And they like at one point I sprayed it on her, and the girl just like lost it. She just started like kind of going crazy in a sense.
I love it.
And it just like, it was this whole thing, and my friends helped me write it. Like, always depended on my friends for to help me choreograph. You know, I had like certain people, they were all still in school too. For the most part, they were all in school, and they would like, we all came together one day, and people were at school, but they like, some of them missed classes. We were coming up with dances on the spot, like just like trying to go. We shot on one of my homegirls like roofs. Like, it was like, just like, it was the dream. It yeah. was the dream.
Full squad effort.
It was the dream. And so many people try to do things out here without like having the help of your friends. Everybody's trying to work up. Yeah. And it's just like, the people around you are the ones. Real. Like, for yo, real. You do this. Like, that's the thing. Like, I don't necessarily rap, but I got my homeboy who's going like write it for me. And I'll be like, yo, I don't want to say that. Speaking of, I got in trouble by my mom. She said, can you not say ass? Can you say back? I said, no, mom, I got to say it. You know what I mean? This is me like going for it. Like,
for real.
With a song like that, I should have been going off of, I should have been cussing, like going like, that's what makes me go there. But I was very respectful in the sense that ass is all I said, you know? And I told my dad, who I really thought I was going to get the problem from, he was like, Keith, you grown. I was like, dad didn't say, mom did. Mom is the cooler one. Like, dad is the one that's usually like, yo, like, can you change it? He's like, yo, you can do whatever you want.
Awesome.
Once again. Man, I'm talking a lot. My throat getting dry. Yeah.
Drink some of that melange.
Mm-hmm. I'm back.
So was that your first like big project into now like your independency is like an actor.
Yeah.
Out of school. That was the first big thing.
People back home started sharing it. I got like, I think I got like almost 5,000 views in a week, and that's good.
How that whole thing?
I was like, I don't even know 5,000 people, but they know me somehow. People are sharing it, and they're loving it because I'm out here doing it. The quality was really good. I had a team of people for like 2013. That quality was like cool. You know what I mean? Like, whenever I do stuff for the internet, I want it to be really nice quality. Like, I don't want it to look like some rundown stuff. Like, if it's on my phone and me acting silly, jumping on tables, whatever. But like, when it comes down to the art that I want to put out, and I want to like, I like to be clean cut. I like to be, you know what I mean? Look at this hat.
For sure.
It's cheap, but it looks nice. It looked like it costs a little penny.
I respect that. You know what I mean? So it could be like, vintage.
Exactly. Could be. But it ain't. But it ain't. But that's the thing. I like polished material. I like it to be polished, and I like it to look like we spent a whole bunch of time and a whole bunch of money. But we didn't. We did not at all. And people were like, how much you spend? Nothing. These are my friends. This is what we do together when we get together. So then I started trying to come up with other ones, and we like, it was more people the second time I came up. I did it. The next video I did was Hollywood crackheads. And you know this, oh my God. I took this offline, y'all. It said, you know the song, I love rock and roll.
Yeah.
So it's Hollywood crackheads. I said, I love rocks and coke. I had a whole group of like crackheads with me. And then before I knew it, it just like transitioned. My dad actually produced some music for it.
Stop.
And then it gets to a point like, and I was surprieved he did, like, you know what I mean? Like, why is he?
Yeah.
He believes still. Yeah, he's supporting.
Yeah.
Yo, before I know it, we Hollywood crackheads doing that. And before I know it, it goes into a dance break, a Thriller dance break. So we coming out like, dun, dun, we just like twitching, twitching. You know what I mean? And we doing it on the roof. We got kicked off the roof. So we did it in the middle of, I think it was Yucca Street in Hollywood.
Doosh,
just like going. I took that shit down, so don't nobody look for it. Maybe one day somebody will find it somewhere. I don't know. But like right now, that's done. And I just like, it had acting and started out, you know, and then it would just go into music. I didn't know I loved music as much as I did. Like, I didn't understand that it was so much of like what I like to do. Like, I think I make funny songs to like mass that I really want to do it. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So it's just
the
like
little guys.
Oh yeah. So like, you guys take this, and I'm over here like, I'm about to really sing. I'm about to really go in. Like, after I'm done, I'm gonna show y'all what I got coming out in next week, and you'll see like the energy is there to like really go there. But incredible. It's just like my friends, like I have one of my friends dance for Chris Brown, a choreograph. It's just like the friends that I have are different now, in the sense that everybody's like working, and it's like a certain level of respect.
Yeah, for sure.
That's, it's not this, the people that used to help me aren't even around. It's wild. So crazy. Like, and they fell off, or like some of them are doing well, but we just not cool no more. Like, got some you. Of them are on tour. It's just like, we kind of not cool, you know, we'll come back around. If I see them, I'm real salty. So I'll be like, well, what's up? Yeah. I feel bad. I'm mad. Oh, remember, we not friends. Like, I'm petty. Like, I'm King Petty. I'm Petty Murphy, y'all.
I love it.
I got issues.
I love it.
I got issues.
Where'd that momentum start taking you? Yeah. Like, mentally and also just, like, within your work?
Well, it was cool because mentally, it was just a constant thing. I used to call Eris every morning with an idea. And we didn't do any of them for real, compared to like how many ideas he would have them. He would write stuff out. You know, we used to call each other every day. It was just like, it was a constant, like, we weren't getting paid for this, but it was just like what we felt good about it. You know, he felt good to help me. Mm-hmm. Like, his brother is doing so, like the Ray brothers, Aaron Ray, Eris Ray, they're just like really talented. Like, I'm like, Eris is on tour right now. Aaron was on X Factor. Now he writing for everybody. Like,
Aaron Ray is one of the illest.
You like
artists.
Aaron Ray?
Bro,
we all went to the same high school. Like,
that's wild.
Dude, we went to the same high school. Like,
he's one of my favorite artists, low-key.
Yeah, he's great.
That communication record with Drum.
He's great. We grew up together. Aaron was that's
wild.
Aaron is Eris's little brother.
That's insane.
So, like, that was, you know, like, the energy that our school, we just are like, you know,
that's
whatever.
Lit.
So, like, we used to call every day. Aaron did a track for me. He did my I Like Chicken video. He did a track. He was just getting off X Factor. I think he just got kicked off. And he did something for me. He was like, okay, whatever. He, like, sampled some stuff. It's like, da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da. And then you had this guy playing drumsticks on a girl's ass. Like, or whatever. I think that's still online. But, like, he did that. We dancing, coming up with choreography on this while Aaron wouldn't jump on it because Aaron was too good. You know, he just got off X Factor.
I feel that.
He's watching us go or whatever. I'm like, Aaron, you want to jump in this? He's like, no, I'm good. All right. I get you, bro. I got to jump in it. Maybe one day. Maybe one day. It's so crazy. Like, just down, like, there was a red carpet event. It's so crazy because we're all doing, like, okay, we're doing well.
Absolutely.
So it was a red carpet event. I'm switching gears. And Aaron, I seen Aaron across the street. He's like, King. I said, what's up? We were going. It was for some movie. I don't know. Me and my castmates were walking there like the carpet. But before we got to it, I saw him. And he was like, what you doing? I said, we about to walk this carpet. He was like, bro. I was like, yeah. I was like, yeah. 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 He said, that's dope, bro. Like, he said, like, I want to, like, help out with it. Like, he's like, oh, you know, like, Eric's still doing his thing. He was like, I want to help out. I want to, like, start doing all. I said, okay. Like, you know what I mean? Cool. Like, cool. You know, like, all of that. So, but going back to the momentum, like, every day, conversations, trying to figure it out, going over Jason's house, who's my director slash editor, who's like almost like managing me in a sense or whatever. Mm. We'd be at the Mendocino Farms where we work, and he'd be sharing, like, he would be telling people that my, like, oh, you need to watch this. Watch this. This is Keith Leak right here. Watch this video. We're both on register. And I get so bashful when that energy is like, put,
yeah.
It's just like, oh,
yeah.
It's just like, oh, sure. Like, no. So I'm like, yo, like, how you doing? This, that, and the other. And he's like, yo, watch it. So one time some kid comes in, and I didn't know, I've seen him a few times, but I didn't know who he was. And he came in, he was like, yo, watch this video, this, that. And he was just talking, Jason was talking to him, however, he talked to everybody else in the line.
Yeah.
So Jason, like, that kid goes, and Jason was like, do you know who that was? I was like, no. Like, he said, that's Ned from Ned's Declassified. His name is Devin Werkheiser. This, that, and the other. And, like, I didn't recognize, like, I've seen the show, but I didn't, that wasn't my show.
Yeah, you
know right, I mean? Right,
but,
right,
like,
sure.
I definitely remember, like, seeing it a couple times, being like, well, this ain't necessarily mine, but I'm gonna watch it. It's on Nickelodeon. Like, what about, what else am I wearing? What else am I gonna watch? And before I knew it, Devin came over. It was rush hour. It was rush hour, and he went and watched my video. It was rush hour at work, and before I knew it, there was a line, and Devin came back over in front of the line. He said, yo, he said, really good work. He said, here, take my number down. This, that, and the other. Like, I was like, okay. You know what all I mean? Right. Like, but that's just what I get. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was just one of those. Like, people will do the work for you in a sense.
For,
like,
sure.
They will promote you. Like, yeah. That's like, oh, like, that's another
I mean, look,
thing.
When you believe in yourself, other people will believe,
dude,
too. You
so
know what I'm
much.
Saying? And especially when it's building a community. You, ooh, know what I'm saying? Like, empowering others in different regard. Like,
yes.
He's getting his directing and editing pop off.
Yes.
You're doing your acting pop. Like, mm-hmm. Everybody coming together to do their little piece. Yeah. Like, wanting.
We not competing.
No.
There's no competition. We're making each other better and greater.
Absolutely.
Incredible.
And when he came over, he gave me his number. Like, I gave him mine. And it was just like, yo, like, I stopped the line for this kid. I didn't know. Nobody knew who he was. You know, like,
yeah.
It's like, over,
yeah.
Like, by Santa Monica and La Brea, there's a lot of studios over there. And, yeah. Like, I was just like, oh, my God. So we texted, and he invited me to, like, do some stuff with him and his friends, like some little creative pieces or whatever. That didn't really come out. But I was able to take my friends, all the people that used to help me, to his parents' house.
Wow.
And for at that point, I was just like, y'all, like, we're
here.
Yeah, we're here. Like, it's just like, yo, like, he just – my friends love the show. They knew the show. Like, they watched it. They watched it. So, like, being able to go there, we're like, I was telling them about it for the longest, and they didn't understand, but we ended up seeing them on the street. He's like, Keith. And, like, I was drunk on the street with my friends. whatever, I said it. And pretty much, like, him, he was with his other co-star, and this is before we went to the Hollywood Hills with
Got
him.
You.
And he was like, Keith, and he was with his other co-star at the, I don't remember her name, but, like, my friends were just like, oh, my God, Keith, do you know who she is? I'm like, no. Like, I don't know. He's like, that's the old girl. I'm like, oh, she was the other one. Like, we're all, like, talking.
Crazy.
And we're hanging out just, like, on the street, just chilling in Hollywood. Like, Hollywood, I've had a lot of great experiences there. And we talked and whatever, and, like, after that, ended up going up to his people's, and it was cool. It was cool to see, let my friends see, like,
for
what
sure.
where we could be.
Yeah,
it wasn't like a paid anything. It was like a community of artists that wasn't, like, you know, necessarily our group. It was other people saying, like, come on, like, we love, like, what you guys do. We love your energy. Let's sit around this fire. Let's talk. Let's whatever. Let's create some stuff. Let's go on the trains and, like, just be some weird kids. Whatever. I was able to take my friends there. And I feel like that helped them believe in me a little bit more.
Mm. For sure.
Yeah.
And you're still getting $50 a week, right?
Yeah.
At this time?
Yeah.
Sometimes 100.
Daddy don't send me no money no more.
Well, I want to say, like,
money no more.
You know, how do you, in terms of momentum and staying creative, how do you also balance that with, like, kind of making a living and just, you know, it sucks being poor. That can drain your creativity.
Yeah.
It sucks to even bouncing around and all that and not even have a stable yeah. place to live.
It's so weird because I found myself a little bit more with where I am now and mm-hmm. just seeing how I'm acting now and how, like, I feel.
Mm-hmm.
If I be quite honest, those times, though, I felt like it was a little bit more fun when I was coming up with it, like, with my friends, you
yeah.
know, like, trying to fit. It was a lot more, it was just, my mind was just going in a different, like, way. It was hard to explain.
No, I get that. Like, I think when you're younger, you don't have as much to lose. You could take more risks.
Yeah.
It doesn't really matter. So, and also, most of the kids around you are poor, too.
Yeah.
And just struggling.
We poor together.
Yeah, and like, struggling. And it's all about that community of, like, you don't feel left out. You don't feel like, oh, people are ahead of me in their careers or anything.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen until you're a little older.
Mm-hmm.
I
think that's where I might be now. That's why I'm starting to feel a certain type of way.
Yeah.
You know, it's.
Especially with acting, though, because, and this is anything creative. I was a musician for a really long time mm-hmm. and experienced a lot of that shit and
nice.
Balancing kind of the creative world, but also paying bills and handling your responsibilities.
Yeah.
And also seeing like other success, you know, people starting to get successful and, mm-hmm. you know, you may not be.
Or, yeah.
You're kind of going through all these weird emotions, but I want to know for you how you were able to kind of take it to that next level of we're just a bunch of crazy creative kids to I really got to start doing this and being an actor, dealing with things like rejection is crazy. Like,
I think when I received the rejection from the management, and that mm-hmm. wasn't a rejection, they still were like trying to get me. I took that as rejection. And
yeah.
I figured out a different way to do what I wanted to do.
Right.
So there was really it was never a change of like.
But were you going on auditions at all?
No, I didn't have like representation. So I was like,
you weren't even going on, not even on your own.
But like, this is the thing. I was working at Mendocino Farms. So like, people would see me and be like, you look like Chris Rock.
Yeah.
Like, I got my first pilot from like being there. Like, it was so cool. It was the coolest situation. I was like, yo, if I know anything, all I have to do is talk to somebody. Somebody got to see me. And that's like, that doesn't happen. It was always like an E! True Hollywood story there.
Yeah. It's a very unique position you're in to take it into kind of your own hands.
Yeah. And like, that's the thing. So many people are like keen on getting representation, like all of that. It's just like, I tell them now, I say, yo, do your own work. I mean, people will see you, like, figure it out, go work, do whatever you got to do. Like, there are no right or wrong ways to get on. There are ways that I would never do some things. I would never do a lot of things, but like, there are no right or wrong answers. Like, how you get on is gonna be different, but like, I was just creating my own work. There was never that thing of like, I gotta like whatever. It was like, I gotta go to work and make I gotta have the best day ever. Cause people love when I'm having the best day, which like now in a sense is like trying to like balance that out. Like, okay, I don't always feel good. So I'm not about to put on like I do. But I did learn from Mendocino Farms, when you put on and you're not having the best day, if you act happy, you will be happy. And that's what I was given back then. So, but there was never like a change. There was never a change. There was never a change.
That's awesome. That's a unique position. Most actors are, you know, trying to get signed by an agency and then audition.
But it doesn't even happen like that. Yeah. Like, just because you get an agency doesn't mean you're
no.
Yo, I didn't get my first, like, my agency until like a couple years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like after I got on, because then it was easy. It was like, of course, you know, following started going, they're like, yo, like, come on. Like, somebody hooked it up with one of my castmates actually. And it was like, cool. It was like, well, I just skipped a whole damn step. I skipped a whole 20 steps.
Do you think because you created all your own content, did all that stuff on your own, that really launched
you? I was able to create like what my brand, if you will. I wasn't getting views like that, but that was like,
sure,
you know, everybody talk about brand this, brand that. I didn't know a brand until I started working this. So I was just like, yo, this is a brand. This is like just huge. Yo, we got like 22 million subscribers,
mm-hmm.
and they've been on YouTube since the beginning of YouTube, like a couple months after it started. So, and we've been in the top, you know, they've been in the top. And just to join something like that, that's when you start to learn brand. It's just like certain things that you can and cannot do. Like, you have to like stick to, like, there is a formula. Like, I mean, we go outside of it, but like having that there, like, it taught me, it's teaching me so much. And, you know, being a black guy in a predominantly white, like, you know, like mm-hmm. whatever, like mm-hmm. it's really like changed how I thought too. Like, it's, ooh, man.
Yeah, talk about that a little bit.
And how'd that come about?
Smosh? Yeah. Okay, so let me explain this. At Mendocino Farms, I used to hook up this girl. Mendocino Farms, I'm telling you, y'all.
Shout out to that prosciutto chicken sandwich. Yeah, that's my Johnny right there.
What about the not so fried?
Ooh.
Don't ask me. Okay, this, y'all, I never passed my test. I never knew what was on the stuff. So I was just wowing people. I was just like, yo, I remember one time I came in a little drunk. and one of the people said, she's like, you can't be here like this. And I was like, I should have got fired, y'all. She was like, go home. I said, okay. I said, I'll be here tomorrow. I was crying. But this girl named Brianna Freypart. Brianna, another person, arms wide open. Oh my God. Brianna used to come in. I used to hook her up all the time. Free sandwiches, free whatever. Like, but I didn't know who she was. I was just giving her free sandwiches. And before I knew it, I found out she was a casting director. But like, whatever, that didn't mean anything. Like, mm-hmm. She's a nice girl. Like, she's cool. Got to the point where she saw me in a YouTube video, not necessarily my own, someone else's, mm-hmm. saw me in it, and she was like, I see you in this video, like, I love them, this, that, and the other. I was like, oh, thank you. Couple days go by, maybe a couple weeks, I don't know the time period, but she ended up coming in again, and I was getting off work, hooked her up. She's like, come sit down with me or whatever, let's start talking. So sat down with her. She's like, yeah, she brought up the video again. She's like, you are like a character. And y'all, I kid y'all not, she said, we got to make you famous.
Wow.
Like, and like, when you hear stuff like that, like with what I was already doing for like creating my own work, it was like, I'm on the right track. If I know anything about working here, about like working with the people I work with as like my friends that help me do the videos, we are on the right track because Absolutely. The people that are seeing and the people that are taking notice and what people are saying is like incredible. Yeah. So I ended up leaving Mendocino Farms, like I want to say like a month later. Mm-hmm. Left Mendocino Farm, started working down the street from where the office is now at this taco shop, right? And it was like a month after that, Brianna hits me up. She said, send all of your information here. And she like, send your videos here and like whatever. And I sent my videos before I knew it. 2 minutes later, I had an email saying, your audition for Smosh, da 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 da. And I went through the whole audition process, yo. And Brianna was the assistant casting director, so she was only in the beginning stages. Like, she wasn't there, but like her friend definitely was looking out for me. But it wasn't like she was like trying to help me. It was just like gotcha.
The funnel,
you know. And dude, before I knew it, I signed. Like,
what was that audition process like for you?
The audition process was
not in terms of like the actual process, just emotionally and what you were going through.
When I tell y'all this, like this kind of makes me emotional because I feel like I kind of lost a little bit of the light that I had back then because I was so hungry. Oh man, good Lord, hold on, save it with your chest. I remember going through the whole process and like listening to like my gospel music or like a little Justin Timberlake. He had this song for real that said Brand New. Yeah. And I was listening to some Fred Hammond, and it was this song talking about like favor and grace. And just like, my heart is for you, like talking about my heart is for God and everything like that. And it was like, that's what I used to listen to. And I was still working at Mendocino Farms, and I was walking, or not Mendocino, the taco shop. The taco. Yeah. So like, I was walking. I remember my friend, I didn't have a place to stay, so my friend was letting me kind of stay with her on what street is that? It's like kind of going up toward the hills in Hollywood, whatever. It was a really nice apartment. And I was remember listening to it the whole process. She was telling me, she said, Keith, you're going to get in, your life's going to change. The lady that was letting me stay with her, Laura, what's up, girl?
What's up, girl?
She was, she kept saying, like, yo, like, you're going to be good. Like, I haven't got her an audition. She was a little older, so they didn't want older people, you know? So yeah. It was a little hard. She was funny as hell, though. She was really funny, great. She let me stay with her. I'm like, yo, like, we all about to get on. I told my homeboy, I told Aris Ray, Aaron's brother, I said, bro, come do this, but he rather went and be an extra and straight out of Compton. I don't know, but like, he helped me get here. So I'm like, bro, I know you black, whatever, we not the same type, but still, like, you come up with my ideas half the time. Like, you help me, like, you help me create and craft these, and you tell me, like, you help direct in a sense, like, you're like hands-on, you know. And yeah. He didn't do that, but I remember crying once I finally got it. once it happened, y'all, I was crying for like weeks. Like, but like not crying, like I was crying because I was happy.
Yeah.
And it would just be emotional. I could like cry at the like a drop of a dime, just so easy, just like tears. I'd be calling my mom, like, mom, like, it's like, what am I doing? Like, what is going on? Like, what? Like, yo, like, I'm just listening to my music, walking up this big ass hill, Beechwood Canyon. Walking up the hill, like, it's so long, it's so, like, tired, but, like, crying, just happy, just, like, I'm getting chills, like, I don't know, and I, oh, my God, just talking about it right now, man, I hate that I felt like I lost a little bit of that light, and that's what it makes me upset at self.
What do you think it is? Because, like,
it's comfort.
It's crazy when we start, you know, thinking about it, especially like music, entertainment, acting, all that. When, you know, you really talk about how the journey is the most fulfilling part.
Yeah.
Like the pursuit of it. Like even when cats get on, like they look back at those days, like as such memorable times.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
What do you think it is about that comfort? Like looking back at it now.
Uh-huh.
What do you think, like, it is in terms of, is it jaded? Is it?
It's just a come up. It's being uncomfortable, but you happen to make it work. You know what I mean? Like, when you get comfortable, you get something, that's your life, and you take it for granted. Like, where I am now, I'll be honest and say, like, sometimes I do take it for granted, and I don't treat it with the care that I should, like, you know, like we all get comfortable, we get complacent,
for sure.
We get bored, you know what I mean? And this is like great. This is like the best opportunity. But the longer you are somewhere, you do feel, you know, like that, you know, sometimes it's like, I don't want to get up. Like, yeah. I mean, that's any
like
job.
The complacent comfort.
Yeah. Like, it's just, it's that, but like you also are reminded, like having conversations like this, or like on the weekends, I'll have conversations and like people that are like, real and like, yo, like what, like how, and I'm like, I'll tell them, and I'm like, okay, that's what I needed. I can go back on Monday and like kill shit. I can kill this whole week of like shooting. I got it. I got the energy. I got the juice. It's like finding it. It's like also, even for me, we shoot so much, it's like a little more difficult for me to do my own stuff, you know what I mean? So it's like also trying to find that. I'm gonna show y'all too, like, yo, y'all get to see it. But just like doing your own work beyond this, like, I mean, we have a hand in the writing process and coming up with characters and all of that, but there is a big machine behind it. But then there's like things that I want to say that we can't say as a group collectively, you know what I mean? So like having that same, you get that fire from doing your own work, period. For sure. And when I do it, like, I get inspired and my friends are like, oh my God, I've never seen you like that. Like, we be dancing, like, okay, so the video that I got coming out is, you know, Michael Jackson's PYT.
Yeah.
So this is NAC, but this stands for Netflix and Chill.
I love it.
So, like, I mean, I got, like, a couple dancers with me. I had two choreographers. We in my house, and we're all dancing. And, like, we just kept going back, and I was like, yo, like, tired. But, like, if I would have stopped, I would have got tired. But when I'm in it, I'm in it. It's just like, you just, it's there. But like, sometimes I find myself getting a little more sleepy. I get sleepy sometimes on like sets where I'm at. And it's just like, yo, like, you got to put that same thing into it. Like, this is your, like, so many more people will see this stuff than like whatever. It's like, but getting comfortable will have you relax in it a little bit.
For
and
sure.
That, y'all, that is not okay. It's not okay.
For sure.
And I've definitely, I think when I first started, I really had a hard time struggling with that. Like, you know, just like trying to figure out my place and like, why am I here, and like all of that. Now I think it's a lot better. Like, I'm happy. Like, I am happy, you know. I'm happy, but then I'm sad, you know.
For
you
sure
have your,
I mean, you're human.
Yeah, I'm human.
There, you know what I mean? And it's always kind of like this introspective process to, you know, I feel like we're in forever in search of who we are.
Yeah, for sure.
It's a blessing that this opportunity on such a big platform, you were able to take advantage of that.
Yeah.
And then it also becomes like, as you're growing within it, you're learning so much. You're seeing so much of the machine operating as well.
It's so, yo, shout out to Smosh. Can I just say that, like, yo, cause it's an incredible group of people. Like, we got like a staff of like 70 some people just for a channel alone, y'all.
Unreal.
Y'all, and that doesn't make sense. Like, this, we put out so much content. Like, it's unbelievable. Like, it doesn't make sense, and we do it, and it, we could not do it on by ourselves. The cast of people that you see, the faces that you see, is not what it is. Like, all holistically,
there's
we play more. We play a big part, but like, there's so many people working while like we're not.
Yeah,
you know, because we can sit around sometimes and like just like text and do. Like, other people are working, like doing social, like figuring it out, like just the whole. Like, it is a team.
Straight
like machine. Our director Ryan Todd. Shout out to Ryan Todd. Like, Ryan Todd is like freaking incredible. He's always just like thinking of stuff, like just thinking and going. Like, this is like, he's working when we're not. Even when he's like at home, like he lives in Sacramento and he flies down. Like, even when he's not working, he'll like just be working. And it's just like overachiever beyond belief. I'm thinking like, I wish I could do that, but it seems a little stressful. So I'll take this complacency right now.
I'll be on my phone.
Right. I'll take this comfortability on my, like, I'm complacent. Yep. You're stressed. Gotta go. But like, those are the people we have working, like real, sure. Like, and then one of our main writer, Ryan Finnerty, he's like incredible. He was just nominated for an Emmy. Like, unreal. There's people doing work outside of the stuff that they do here. Like, Ryan is a great like example of that. He's incredible. He's doing his thing right now. He was just like talking about some things that he has in the works, and just seeing how like you hear all the time, Monday through Friday, and you hear before everybody, and sometimes we're a little late, and you try to make sure we own our stuff, but you're also writing when you go home. You got a son, you got a wife, you just got a house, like, not too long ago, like, you know what I mean? Like,
Life happens,
you know, he's doing it, like, why isn't he getting, like, these certain deals, like, I can't talk about, but, like, it's just like, and you would think this would be the only thing that he does, because it's so, like, consistent, and it's so, like, it's so much Monday through Friday. Where's the time for him to go and write something else that's something bigger, like TV?
For real.
Once, I don't know. Look, I will take the, I'm over here like it's putting it in perspective, but like my whole thing right now is like I'm too complacent. I'm not doing all that I should. I'm not. And I'm like, and once, if I just do a little bit, y'all, like, things happen. Things work. And I know that from just how everything has happened for me out here. But just, like, seeing these people are, like, incredible. I got to go back to work on Monday and hug everybody. Because the more I talk about it, I'm like, yo, like,
I love it.
You are the truth. Like, you are the truth. And the light. Jesus.
Why do you feel... Shout out to the Reverend.
Hey, turn down your vehicle, bro.
Go back to your normal exhaust, bro.
I mean, look. I think for face value, the complacency probably comes from, all right, now you're okay. How do you find yourself getting over that complacency?
Is honestly going back to creating own work, because that's what I wasn't. I wasn't any of that when I was doing specifically what I wanted to do with the people that helps me. People believe and people will help. You know what I mean? Like, I've seen it happen for myself this whole time I've been out here. When I'm creating my own stuff specifically, that's when I can, like when I did the video for the Netflix and Chill, I was able to, like, I was a little bit more happier at work. Because I did my own stuff, you know? So, like, when you create your own work on top of that, you do get a lot more fulfillment. Like, you're fulfilling yourself. You're fulfilling your dream. Like, this is there. Like, and that will be there. And it's great. And it's, like, we get millions of views. Like, people see us. People are, you know, people love what we do.
Yeah.
You know? And sometimes, like, we, like... It's just about doing your personal stuff.
For sure.
It's really about doing that. Like,
getting back to your kind of core of why you did it in the first place.
Yeah. Like, this is what got me here. Like, I'm still kicking. It's just like, why haven't I put out... I haven't put out, like, one video on my YouTube channel yet. Like, and I've been there for, like, a few years. And it's just like, you know, like, why haven't I done that?
At the end of the day, it's literally up to us and the man in the mirror.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Dude, straight up, I love Michael Jackson. So I was just talking about that song earlier. I was like, yep, that's what it is. Like, man, if you don't do it, like, I know what it is.
Yeah.
I feel like we have awareness. People, we try to act like we all know why we upset,
what's
going on. We take out our problems on everybody else and, like, what's going on. But we know what the problem is. Like, I need to do my own work on top of having this great opportunity there. Like, then people can really see who I am, like, on a more personal level.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Like, beyond just, like, the five, the six of us, you know? And I mean, like, that's all great. And that's a great representation. Like,
for sure.
I love it. Like, I'm happy to be there. But, like, personal fulfillment, or I won't feel as complacent when I do my own, you know? And I think everybody should, like, regardless of when you're with a group and collective, also having your own work out there and doing that will make you even feel better.
Finding yourself.
Yeah, don't put your eggs in one basket. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I got this basket here, and it's a big basket. A big basket. But, like, what about my little one over here? I ain't put no eggs in it. You know what I mean? We got all these eggs, and people just throwing eggs. You got the 75 group team. I got this little egg, and I got three people that I'm, like, really, like, yo, let's do this real fast. Like, let's go and, like, figure it out. Let's make it, like, some, like, whatever. Let's make this stuff that, like, it's a little bit more personal in this sense, or you know what I mean? It's just like, this is the vibe for me right now. Like, why I ain't put no eggs in there? I could, like, I have the tools to take some of these eggs over here and put them there. Mm-hmm. Doesn't even do it. Mm-hmm. It's like, what the hell am I doing? You know,
for
like,
sure.
You won't feel good. You will feel complacent. That's why it is. I mean, at the same time, I will, like, it's great. It is great. It's great. Like, it could be a lot worse. Like, it's absolutely. it's not even like the bad complacency. Like, I mean, being complacent is bad.
Yeah.
But, like, it's not like the worst of it. It's like
the world's gonna end.
Oh no, it ain't none of that. Like, right. I'm still with that big basket over there. Yeah. I'm still good. I'm nice. Cracking eggs. It's like, you know, just like whatever. Cracking eggs and somebody's throwing some other ones, you know?
Word. What are you most excited about right now? Like, just like being able to look back and just kind of look towards the future. Where do you want to take Keith's journey?
Everywhere. Continue to do the things that I've been doing, you know, and just learn self, continue to live. Like, incredible. You know what I mean? There's so much more to, like, I keep saying, like, creating your own work and, like, once I get back into that, I'll be able to, like, really tell you you know what I mean?
For sure.
But, like, once I do that, that's when I know. That's when I just walk in faith. That's when I'm just, like, going.
Yeah.
That's when it's, like,
the stride is just on.
Dude, before I got out here in Wentzville, Missouri, I was staying with my dad, like, for, like, the summer, right before I got out here. And, like, this pastor, he said, yo, like, this is what you do. He said, think it. Say it, pray on it, believe it, act on it, and, like, you good. And that's what I've done. And, like, I find myself not doing that as much. And I feel that. I feel it. It's just like, I didn't say it. What if I just said it? Like, you get to a point where sometimes you don't even want to say it. You don't feel that you're worthy enough to say it.
Yeah.
It's just like, I don't feel good, or like, I don't feel good. So I'm not going to say it. No. Like, you got to say it even when you don't feel good.
For sure.
Like, once I do my own stuff again, you know, with, like, being here, because I'm not going anywhere, you know, but like doing my own work. Like, I'll be able to tell you clearly, like, where I want to go. Like, I have an idea.
Yeah.
But, like, once I'm in that zone, it's absolutely. Like, that's where I want to go.
I love it.
You know? I just want to go there. I want to go. When I create, that's when you figure it out.
I have absolutely no doubt that you'll get there.
Oh, thank you, brother.
You know what I'm saying? I also have absolutely no doubt that you'll continue to grow and blossom. And, like,
thank you, man.
There will evolve.
Thank you. I'm really, like, you see, I'm up here like, thanks, bro. Thanks, big
bro. For real. For real, though. No, like, it's just inevitable. You know what I mean? Like, it's because, look, the biggest part in my eyes of why I can even say that with such confidence is, like, you have to be able to see what's missing in your world.
Mm-hmm.
And being able to address that makes it so much easier.
Yeah.
A lot of us are lost just for the sake of being lost, or a lot of us are feeling some type of way, like we kind of touched on earlier, and it's like, don't know why, or I'm just so, you know, confused.
It's
but
like, common sense is just really not like, look, common. It's there,
nobody,
y'all.
This is the thing. Nobody's perfect.
Yeah.
Right? Perfection does not fucking exist.
My mom told me I was perfect in Nushan.
Well, you perfect then.
thank you.
Mama's eyes.
Thank you.
Right?
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like pursuit is really what energizes us.
Yes.
You know, for whatever our calling is, or mm-hmm. whatever our pivots are, or whatever the possibilities that we see are. And just, you know, I find myself at times being like, damn, but like you've repeated yourself for 2 weeks straight. Like, what the fuck is new in your world? Mm-hmm. Or like, look at myself in the mirror and be like, all right, but like, we need to step it up a little bit.
Like,
you're getting complacent.
Yeah.
You're getting comfy.
Right.
I'm not liking how this feels.
Right. switch it up.
It's, yeah, because like, we have the power to do so.
We got the tools.
We do.
We got it.
And you
we
got the juice.
The juice. You got the, oh, you got the gas.
You got the Jerry Curl drip juice. You know what I'm
about to take off my hat, but I'm like the S Curl. My hair broke off. Y'all, my hair broke off in the center. I just wore my, stop wearing
but,
hats, y'all.
But like you said, I think it's so much about the pursuit, and it's interesting that you could get so caught up with the end goal of like that. When you actually get there, you're like, you take that moment to be emotional, to enjoy it, and then you're like, all right, I'm here.
Yeah.
What's
but,
next?
But now what?
Yeah.
You know, like that big fantasy in your mind of whatever it was. Mm-hmm. When you get there, it's not exactly what it looks like. It's still work, still a job.
Yeah.
It's still something you have to show up for, and it may not even be something you're 100% passionate about.
Yeah.
And you have to rediscover that.
Yeah,
for sure.
And and I think, like you said, man, the pursuit is so much of what wakes you up in the morning.
Yeah.
And I think that's why when you were kind of younger before all that, and everyone goes through this, and that's how, well, one of the reasons why we even started this podcast was to talk about that before period, because that's when you do look back and you're like, it was crazy. We were broke. We didn't know what we were doing. Yo. We were just doing.
And also, like, damn, I did that?
Can
and
I tell y'all crazy. This? Like, my dad, when I was working at Mendocino Farms, he was like, Keith, you're doing your own videos. You got your friends. You got this. You got that. You don't got no kids. He said, you're living the dream.
Absolutely. Yes.
Like, but while I was working there, and I didn't quite understand it, it was like, no, like, right now it would make more sense for me to say I'm living the dream.
For
like
sure.
From the places I'm able to go or like, you know, who I talk to, or who I rub shoulders with.
Yeah.
But like, no, that was it. And no, this is still it. Like the dream don't stop.
The
like,
dream does not stop.
Look, and I tell people like, I'm like, I ain't shit right now. Like if you see this right now, like I'm like having this conversation, I don't take it lightly because it's reminding me, y'all, I've been down, just defeated. Like I've been going to the office and I've not been like, you know what I mean? There's like, there's been like some like just not okay. And people are like, you okay, Keith? I'm like, I'm good. You know,
yeah,
it's just
you have
time.
To put the about face on.
Yeah. You know, it's like, I'm good, but you know, I'm not, you know, they like, you've been a little sad lately. You know, people check in.
For
like,
sure.
What's wrong?
I'm like,
talk about it, whatever.
Yeah.
But like, dude, like, it's the dream. It's the dream. Like even this at this low point, and this is not even the lowest.
Yeah.
This is the dream. Like dreams sometimes it's not a nightmare. It's just like it's not a bad dream. It's just like a feeling in a dream that's just like, well, this happened. Like, you know.
You're not in the sunken place.
No. Hell no. Don't hold on. Somebody got shit. There is some tea right here. I look at it.
And I mean I think that's so interesting why this is, like you expressed, it is a low point for you.
Mm-hmm.
When on paper, it's completely opposite.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you appreciate that. Like, you know where you are. But the definition of success, the definition of, like, what that dream actually is, all those things change when you're really in it and you're going through it and you're realizing, like, okay, this is the dream, but kind of like Mendocino Farms was the dream.
Yeah.
And doing my own things.
Yeah.
And
the dream always changes. Yeah. That's the beauty of it. Like, we're at different points in our lives.
Yep.
Like,
discover things that make you continue. To make you happy.
Ooh, straight up. Like, I'm still learning. I'm still learning, and I look forward to learning more. I really do. Like,
I look forward to continuing to see you live out your dreams.
Oh,
brother.
Man.
For real.
Man, shut up.
I love you.
Yeah, you feel all good. I'm about to go home and just be like, oh, look at my Michael Jackson posters on my wall. I'm in the right place.
When was the last time you drew?
Oh. It's actually funny. I actually drew something last week, and it was my, so one of my friends is like into like merch and stuff. So like, we're trying to do something there, and I want to go too deep into it, but like, I drew something for the merch.
Awesome.
Yeah. So it's like, it works.
Incredible.
You know, 'cause I want it to be personal. I don't want it to be like, just like some, like, yo, these are some words on a t-shirt.
Yeah.
Like, that's dope too. I'll rock it. Like, you know, people do it. I love that too. But for me, it's just like, if I can utilize this number two pencil, this H2, whatever I decide to use, like, I feel like I can make it more personal. And, you know, I want people to spend money on something that has my face on it. So I drew me, of course.
But I love it.
I did it.
The ode to you from you.
Yeah. See, I love myself sometimes.
I love it. Let that flourish. You feel me?
So look, sometimes.
It's been incredible, my brother. Thank you so much.
Oh, no. Dude, hold on. It's over? What are we doing now? I'm staying forever. I'm coming back. I got to come back.
No, you for sure are coming back.
This is, you know.
I mean, we got the autobiography out. Now, yeah. Like, whenever it is, 6 months, a year, 2 years,
yeah.
Then we get to talk about the hitter moments.
Okay.
Because it's like the first album.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, this is my first one?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. This ain't a masterpiece. I got like 4 stars, I feel like.
You got 5 in my book.
You got 5. I got 5.
You got the Nushi and Roushi 2 thumbs up. Shout out to Siskel and
Ebert.
How many mics? Should I give you 5 mics?
5 mics, baby.
Yeah,
look, like I said, so much. why this is so important is to highlight everything that led up to someone Googling you right now.
Yeah.
And we can do that. Google, you can find out a lot more about you.
Can I say this real fast?
Say that.
You better
say it fast.
Okay, I'm gonna say it real fast. No, this is real fast. So, Googling. So the other day, my homegirl was like hosting something at this like club downtown.
Yeah.
And I ain't have my ID. I lost my my identification, my whole wallet in the airport, Baltimore airport. Man, I'm upset. left it there. Didn't have an ID, but she was hosting it. Got to the point where she had to go tell security, and somebody was like, "Well, can we look them up?" He was like, "Yeah." They looked me up on Famous Birthdays. I said, "What the hell?"
I ain't never used that card.
I just want to say that people can Google me, y'all, and I got a famous birthday, which means nothing. It means nothing. But I was like, I ain't got no ID. Y'all need an ID. You need an ID. I'm on Famous Birthdays. Like, it's stupid. It's so dumb.
I love it.
It's amazing, though.
That was incredible. I love that.
I'm not even gonna ask where people can find you. They can Google you.
Yeah. Google me on Famous Birthdays.
Keith Lee Jr.
And
thank you. No S.
And honestly, thank you for coming on here
and
just being vulnerable and getting into the nitty gritty of some of those really special moments.
Yeah.
And highlighting the points where you don't want to forget. You know the things that led to where you are that really are the most important part of all this.
Yep.
So thank you for getting there.
Right. Yeah, damn Skippy. Dang, my boy's getting deep. My ball's dropping.
And we out.